Today we're actually going to talk about a very interesting... We're outside, so if I'm yelling, it's because I'm outside and I'm afraid you might not hear me with 6'10 in the background and all that kind of stuff.
But we wanted to get our lunchtime vitamin D.
Yes.
Because that's the most significant time to get your sunlight.
It's a beautiful day right after the first Astros victory ever in the World Series. Super exciting. So we decided to come outside and take advantage of that. But I wanted to talk about, there was a study that came out of the UK, and I'm going to have Dr. Ginsberg go into detail about it, and you can see from our title what we're talking about.
And we can post the study.
We can post the study, but this study looked at vegetarian and, was it vegan moms
just
also?
Low, everybody, low meat consumption. So I think it was a sort of a continuum. Low meat consumption during pregnancy, and then looked at adolescents at 15 years old and gave them kind of an electronic questionnaire.
So the offspring of the mothers.
Correct.
Whose diet they were looking at.
Correct.
Okay.
And looked at substance abuse, that predisposition to substance abuse. And by substance, I mean alcohol, cannabis or pot, and tobacco. So mom wasn't necessarily a vegetarian or a vegan, but they wanted her whole diet, all the way up to people that were good red meat eaters, and then they looked at the kids, and what they found...
Was it just red meat they were looking at, or all meat?
Meat, yes.
Okay, so it wasn't just red meat, it was meat consumption in general.
But when they broke it down, in other words, they looked at the moms that way, but when they actually looked at the study said low red meat, and I think they mean that in terms of, you can't look at just fish. Sorry,
okay,
we're commuting with nature. So it was low red meat. So in other words, and I think the reason again is the point that they wanted to really look at is it wasn't fish and vegetables and greens, and it wasn't just chicken. It was the concept of what you and your microbiome are getting out of red meat that you are going to then give your gestating, if you will, baby, and how that will affect development.
Okay,
correct.
So they found that the women that had the lowest meat consumption had a higher probability of a child becoming a substance abuser
correct,
as an adolescent.
Correct. And they tried to also separate out people that ate more carbohydrates. I think they said in the study, you know, higher confectionery sugars, and they couldn't link that. It was the low red meat consumption that really made a difference. So it really brings up an interesting topic of pregnancy. It brings up an interesting topic of what should you do? What should you do? What do different societies do? What about people that supposedly come from present vegetarian societies now? What if people decide to become vegetarians? So I think for us, and we'll talk about a little bit of that, is that it starts, number one, with not just prenatal care, but preconception care.
So before you actually get pregnant, you need to be thinking about what you're eating.
Correct. What's going on in your gut, your gut microbiome, or the bugs themselves, how they're pulling foods apart and providing nutrients to you, and how your system is taking those nutrients and using them. And I think the thing that they found biggest in this study was that people that ate low red meat had a significantly low amount of B12. Now, why would B12 be so significant, so important?
Well, so a few things before I address that. I do want to say that this was a causation correlation study, and on some level, that is kind of junk science, and a lot of your good researchers will admit that. I mean, you know, that Chris Kresser gives a great example of, like, you know, ice cream consumption is high during the summer, but shark attacks are also higher, so therefore high ice cream consumption makes you more likely to get eaten by a shark, which is ridiculous. And so it is hard for people to remember what they ate when they were pregnant, and that's my biggest, criticism with the documentary What the Health, which I think was really poorly done. Horrible research, and so I want to, you know, just kind of throw that out there, that is something to consider. But I will say there were no vegan societies when you look back ancestrally, no vegetarian societies that chose to be that way. And I'm not speaking an opinion, I'm just telling you a fact. When you look at anthropologically, there was no society that chose to eat that. They would trade for meat. It was pretty precious. Now, given that statement, how much is really necessary, I feel like it's very different based on the person. I will tell you that if you look at nutritionally, the ability to absorb B12, there are cofactors in it that will not come from plant sources. I think that's one of the biggest things that no one can really argue with. Even if you ask vegans, they know that they're going to be deficient in B12, and that is a key nutrient involved in methylation, which is key for neurotransmitters, which would be something that would affect development in something like this, I would assume, because of the dopamine and things Correct. Like that that are involved in substance abuse.
Correct. So slowly. So dopamine, remember, makes you kind of happy, and serotonin makes you sort of sleepy, and that balance is important. So methylation, the methyl group, which is a carbon-hydrogen group, which comes off your leafy greens. Yes, so the vegan, vegetarian, right, you're getting, maybe getting those methylfolate groups, but you need B2, B3, and B6 in order to continue that process. And you need DHA to continue that process. And that comes from your red meat products. Plus your microbiome.
Meat, fish as well.
Correct. But and that gets affected. So the ability of the microbiome or the gut to take these like light bright pegs and use the greens efficiently is, I think, what you lose. So what happens, I want you to visualize, if that cycle doesn't spin, the balance isn't there, the light bright pegs don't go on the DNA where they need to be, and the neurotransmitter, the dopamine, I feel okay, serotonin, I need to sleep, doesn't balance. So you could almost visualize you need more substance stuff, alcohol or cannabis or smoking. You need those things to now get on your cells where the other groups couldn't get there, to almost make you feel normal. And I would probably, if I could give a 3-minute or 2-minute science lesson on it, that's where I would think a lot of that came from. So it goes into then things that you get from your red meat, but also looking at how you're getting your B12.
Yeah, so kind of conclusion, are we saying that you cannot be a vegetarian during pregnancy? No, we are not saying that. I know a lot of really healthy vegans and vegetarians, and I do feel like the good thing about that lifestyle is that people are very conscious of what they're eating. They're very conscious of how they're sleeping, mm-hmm. how they're exercising, how they're managing stress, where they're getting their food from, is it organic, not organic? And so I do see a lot of really healthy people follow that diet. My biggest concern is the deficiencies that can come from cutting out that complete group. And so, like DHA, for example, which comes primarily from fish, you could get it from sea sources such as seaweed. You could get it from flaxseed. You could get it from chia seed. But the conversion of that
is not efficient.
To DHA is not efficient. And it depends on your genetics how well you do that at all. So there are some people that can thrive better on a vegetarian diet than someone else. Supplementation can definitely help, but a lot of people that are vegans do not want to go with a fish source for their DHA supplement, or they don't want to go with a meat source for their B12, and really the supplements that are in plant form have not been shown to absorb well. So we just want to give you the facts and kind of raise some concerns about that.
And be careful on your carbohydrates. A lot of times what happens is you tend to eat a lot more carbohydrates when you eat more of a vegetarian diet.
Refined carbohydrates.
Yes. And more complicated or complex. And if your gut microbiome is off, depending on life, and maybe if ancestrally you're supposed to be a meat eater, that will tip, then you can't digest the carbohydrates that you're eating, and so you wind up bloating and uncomfortable, and that gives you more GI issues, so you're not absorbing your nutrients in the first place, and that can add to more and more of a vicious cycle.
Now, how much meat do you eat? That would be very individual also. I mean, a little bit can go a long way, especially if it's from a very good source.
Yeah.
You know, if you wanted to do primarily fish and you're looking at the smaller fish that are not as high in mercury, that would also be okay. So I feel like that is an individual thing, but it isn't like you have to turn into a caveman and eat only meat to be able to get that B12. I mean, I think for most people, if they had 3 ounces of meat twice a day, they would be very well on their way of meeting that requirement if they have good stomach acid, which is a whole other
conversation.
You have to be able to digest your food to get that B12 out of it.
So read the study, we'll post it. The study did say that just fish wasn't enough. They really needed some of the red meat. So again, I think it goes back to what the bugs in your gut want also. If you go against what makes them happy, there's a big part of that. So we can look at your micronutrients, as you know, with some testing. Keep yourself as balanced as you can. Please, before 6-8 months, a year before, probably your whole life, but even at least 6-8 months, a year before, make sure that things are balanced before you even think about getting pregnant.
Before you get pregnant is the time to think about what is your diet look like there, now, and then what is it going
there's a great book where I can't remember what his name is, the guy that says that 24 days into pregnancy, a lot of the genetic code is
nutrient power.
Right. And I can't remember what's his name.
William Walsh.
Is great book, says 24 days into pregnancy, your genomic setup is already there. So get your vitamin D, keep your life, your diet balanced, and